När första ljuset brinner står julens dörr på glänt och alla är så glada att fira få advent. Hi and welcome. It's November 29th and we are celebrating First Advent. I thought this Christmas that I would make a mini-series talking about Christmas and the Swedish Jul. I want to talk to you about my traditions and the Swedish traditions surrounding this holiday, which I hold very dear. I talk a lot about the issues going on within my country and going on in the West, but I also want to spend some time talking about the things which I want to preserve. I want to spend a little time sharing with you a bit of my culture. Swedish Christmas, which we call Jul, is in many ways a combination of both Christian and pagan traditions. Unlike a lot of Westerners, we don't call it any variation of the word Christmas. We call it Jul, as in the Swedish word for wheel. The English also had a 12-day festival, which they called Jul. Let me quote a BBC article on the theorized origins of that name. The pagan celebration of winter solstice, also known as Jul, is one of the oldest winter celebrations in the world. Ancient people were hunters and spent most of their time outdoors. The seasons and weather played a very important part in their lives. Because of this, many ancient people had a great reverence for and even worshipped the sun. The Norsemen of the Northern Europe saw the sun as a wheel that changed the seasons. It was from the word for this wheel, Hjul, that the word Jul is thought to have come from. At midwinter, the Norsemen lit bonfires, told stories, and drank sweet ale. What I read to you here in the beginning of this video is the first part of a four-piece poem that I grew up reading every Advent. You read a part of it for every Advent. So you read the first part of the poem on the first Advent, the second part on second Advent, and so on. So what is Advent then? Advent is Latin and it means arrive. It is sort of like a countdown to the birth of Jesus in a Christian context, and where each Advent is it has an individual meaning in the story. I asked my Swedish friends on Twitter what Advent meant to them. For a lot of you, it means that the spirit of Jule enters the home, like in the poem. You get to put up the Advent star and the Advent chandeliers, which is what I have right here behind me. You get to put up any Christmas decorations that you'd like. For others, it means having that special moment with your family around the candle and around fika, having julfika together. It also means that you can start consuming the jul food, or Christmas food, and drinks like julmust, glögg, pepparkakor, lussekatter, Christmas ham, and so on. The Northern Museum in Stockholm writes on their website that the tradition is tied to stillness and reverence. Weddings were not allowed during this time, and you were also to avoid noisy construction work. For this first Advent, me and my friend Nils decided to make some traditional lussebullar, have some fika, and enjoy the first glögg of the season and of the year. So we decided to make some saffron buns because they are so heavily tied to Advent and Jul. Baking these sorts of treats is really something that gets me in the holiday season. I have very fond memories of baking with my family the days before Christmas, and I have very fond memories of having that Advent fika. I still get that warm Christmas feeling when December starts. My mom is the one who would always make the saffron buns in my family, and she really has found a way to perfect them and make them big and fluffy. This is the first time I make them on my own, so we'll see how it'll go. So what I'm doing here is I'm melting 200 grams of butter. The recipe called for 175, but I chose to add a little bit extra. You always should add a little bit extra of the good stuff. And I'm pounding the saffron with just a little bit of the sugar to get that taste out of it. And then I'm pouring it into the melted butter. And then when you've mixed that together, you're gonna add about 5 deciliters of milk. And it should be this beautiful yellow, reddish color. And then you should warm that up until it gets 37 degrees or somewhat. I accidentally warmed it a little bit too much, and I was very nervous because I didn't notice this until I was making the dough, until I added the flour. And so you can't do this with active yeast, as we used, because the active yeast stops working if it gets too hot, if it gets over 40 degrees. So, but it actually didn't seem to be that big of a problem. And then you're gonna add 2 deciliters of sugar. I think we added a little bit extra here too, because like I said, add a little bit more of the good stuff, and 2 teaspoons of salt, or 1.5 teaspoon of salt, maybe it was something like that. And then you start adding the flour. So you're going to mix the flour in. So you're almost going to mix all of the flour, but not really all of it. Try to get it really well mixed in. And then you're going to work the dough, knead it for about 2-5 minutes.
Sen när det är dags att klåda, då får du klåda.
This is Jelly Bean
Jen, the cooking channel.
Gonna make some changes to my YouTube channel. I bet you didn't expect a cooking show.
Så, ska vi ha med mer?
Nej, du ska, den ska ju 5 minuter.
Ja, ska jag bara stoppa så här nu? Jag kände av.
The will to live left my body.
And then when it's all mixed together and you work the dough for 5 to 10 minutes, you're gonna just cover it up and let it rest. Let it take a little nap for about an hour. The recipe calls for it to rest 2 times, but we're just gonna let it rest 1 time a little bit longer. And look at that! It has risen quite a bit. So I was worried about the dough being too hot or the mix being too hot, but it has risen, so I guess it wasn't that big of an issue. And then you're gonna put it on a floured work station, and you're gonna work it. I know it looks kind of bad that I'm using a knife, but it's a very dull knife, and because I didn't have the right tool, don't worry, I'm not destroying the knife or cutting myself with it. And you're just gonna work the dough and make it into little pieces that you're gonna shape into the shapes that you want. There are multiple shapes that you can make these buns into. I chose to make the traditional S, and Nils decided to make just round shapes that you're gonna see later. So that's what they look like. So like I said, I haven't really, it was a really long time since I made these with my family even. So I didn't really have the right technique to start with. Some of them turn out really ugly, like that one.
The sad boy.
Den här blir den finaste. Nu fick 2 russin.
First.
Sen är vi in i ägg. Kanske lite väl aggressivt.
So what I'm doing here is I'm just coating all of the saffron buns with a little bit of egg to give them a nice surface, or a nice coat, a nice top. And here are Nils's buns, the untraditional buns. So I wanted to do a little bit of research about these buns or these pastries, and according to one interpretation, the tale behind the saffron bun, which is more closely translated as saffron cat, originated in Germany in the 1600s. According to that tale, the devil, in the shape of a cat, would beat up children, while Jesus, in the shape of a child, would hand out buns to nice children to keep the devil away, who was afraid of the light. They would color these buns with the yellow saffron spice. They don't have to be in the oven for that long, just have them in for like 8 to 10 minutes, and then cover them up and let them rest, or just eat them right away. You do as you please.
Nice.
Nice. Now that the saffron buns are done, we're just gonna sit down and have a fika, which is entirely essential to the Swedish Advent. And I want to just note that a lot of the things may be universal or may be celebrated elsewhere as well. So when I say it's Swedish, I'm not necessarily saying that it is strictly Swedish, although some of the things that I'm going to be bringing up in this series definitely are. So what we're drinking to this fika is the traditional glögg. So it is a mulled and spiced wine that you heat up on the stove, and it is served together with raisins and with almonds. So the glasses that we're using are glögg glasses, but they're kind of, they don't have to be that small, but they're typically kind of smaller coffee cups. And so you put the almonds and the raisins at the bottom and then you drink it. So most spices in glögg are cloves, cinnamon, cardamom, and ginger. Other common ingredients can include citrus peel from oranges or lemons. Glögg can also be made without alcohol by replacing the wine with fruit or berry juice. In shop, ready-made glögg is usually based on grape juice, sometimes also blackcurrant juice, mixed fruit juice, apple juice, or wine. Thank you so much for watching this video and for hanging out today. I hope that you stay tuned for the rest of the series. I think that next time we're going to be talking a little bit about our tradition of Lucia. We might also be making some pepparkakshus and talking a little bit about the Scandinavian Santa or the Scandinavian tomte. Happy Advent and see you next time. Bye.